All right. And now to induct Bret the Hitman Hart. There are some people who need no introduction. But if you don't give this next guy one, he'll open up a can of whoop-ass on you, and I don't want that to happen here tonight. I'd like to say a lot of nice things about this guy, but I'd rather be honest. He is not a nice man. As a matter of fact, he is the meanest, he is the toughest son of a bitch in the WWE, Stone Cold Steve Austin!
You know, I was going through my bag in the back. You know, it's funny. I was going through my bag in the back, and I couldn't find something. I lost something. I went in the back looking through my bag, and I found a can of whoop-ass, and it had Hulk Hogan's name on it. Damn right. It's a good night to be up here today with all these legends, and it's fun for me, and it's a great honor, and I know everybody's been saying that, but I really mean it, because I ain't the most humble son of a bitch in the world. You got the black jacks over here, the black trunks, the black boots, the black vests, the bad attitude. If I could have ridden down the roads with you guys, it would have been great. I never told Sherry this, but I've always been in love with her. I just thought she was sexy, gorgeous, and just a tremendous work. I just loved everything she did. You were talking about the blondes a little bit earlier in the evening. I just loved everything you did. A lot of people don't know this, but I travel up and down the road with Tony Atlas. And where's that cheapskate Mick Foley, because he traveled with us. And everybody knows that Tony was a great bodybuilder, and he's a great power lifter, and a great wrestler too, but he was also a great beer drinker. And we'd ride up and down the road, and he was good, but he couldn't drink as much as Stone Cold could, I'll tell you that much right now. But we'd drink beer until the late hours of the night, and then me and Tony would go to the gym, and I'd be working chest, bench pressing about 225 for about 4 or 5 reps, and Tony'd be over there bouncing 500 off his chest about 10, 15 times. It really pissed me off. So it's good to be here tonight, and you know, I'm here to talk about a guy that I've always respected before I even knew him. And I've always had a deep respect for the great workers in the business, the great technicians, and the great storytellers. And Bret Hart never was the biggest guy in the business. He never was the flashiest guy in the business. But I always had an unbelievable chemistry in the ring with him. And I knew that anytime the bell rang, there was a trust and there was a level of respect in there between us, and just good things always seem to happen. I remember one time I was laying at the house on my couch. I was watching Monday Night Raw. Of all things, I had a busted knee. And I'm listening to the announcing, and this is back when Vince used to do the announcing. And it was WrestleMania 13 right here in Chicago at the Rosemount. It's my favorite building to wrestle in. It's just a magic environment. And I hear the guy here, Vince, he goes, yeah, and in a submission match, it'll be Bret the Hitman Hart versus Stone Cold Steve Austin. And that was news to me, because I was watching the broadcast and I didn't know a damn thing about it. And it got me kind of hot, because I'm not a submission wrestler. You probably know that from watching me. I only got about 3 offensive moves. So when I showed up to Chicago that night, I remember I needed to get in shape for the match, but I had a busted knee, so I stopped drinking for about 17 days. And Lanza commented how good I looked. And I remember going to the match that night, and I was thinking it was at a point in my career where I needed something big to happen. The King of the Ring had already happened. I cut a promo, which kind of put me on the map. And this was kind of put up or shut up time. It was a semi-main event that night, and a submission style match. And I just knew that we were going to go out there in my favorite town to work, in my favorite building, and completely stink the joint out. And what we did was go out there, and things happened, and it was the greatest match of my career. And I've had a lot of great matches after that, but Jack Lanza came up to me and he said, you'll probably never have a match like that again. And he kind of was right. We never really achieved anything like that again. But anytime I stepped in a ring with Bret, whether it was overseas or here in the States somewhere, I wrestled him a million times. And Bret was a guy that always showed up. He didn't miss a shot. Now, he always showed up late, but he never missed his shot. So I'm proud to induct him into the Hall of Fame tonight. He's a guy that has always called himself the excellence of execution. He lives that, he breathes that, and he truly believes it in his heart, and that's why he was so good. He is the best there is, he's the best there was, he's the best there ever will be. He's Bret the Hitman Hart.
Say, it's an honor to be here, and it's an honor to be up here with so many great legends, like everybody said. And nobody's more surprised and more amazed to be here than I am. But this is a big night for me. And despite what anyone thinks, many years ago when I had my fallout with Vince McMahon at the Survivor Series and all that, I made a promise to myself that day that if they ever asked me to do the Hall of Fame, I would be here. I want to say that while I'll never forget what the WWE took away from me, I also want to say that I'll never forget all the great things that they gave to me. And I've had a great, great life, and I've had a great career here. And I want to first of all thank the McMahons, especially Vince, for giving me the chance to work on his canvas. Every night that I went out years ago when I first started, I was just honored to be in the ring and wrestle for the WWE. You know, when I think back years and years ago, when I was about 3 years old, I think I was watching my first wrestling matches on TV, and I was watching Killer Kowalski. And I think in my family, everybody just became ingrained in you right from the very start to love this business and love the circus life. And my family growing up, I mean, everybody loved wrestling, and we've always been grateful for all the adventures and stories that we've had through this great business. And I want everyone to know that I came here to celebrate my career, not to mourn over it. And I had a fortune cookie today that said, you're welcome in any gathering. And my Chinese fortune cookie today. I want to go back to when I was a little kid. I remember going to the wrestling matches for the very first time. And I'd be riding in the car down to the wrestling matches with my brothers. And it was like right from the very start, I remember I'd be riding in the car and my dad would pull up to the hotel. And I remember when I was real young, they picked up the midgets. And I remember thought, cool, you know, I finally got some wrestlers that I can play around with, you know. And it was I remember Skyla Lowe and Little Beaver and that whole bunch, they just all get in the back seat. My dad had a big old, it was like a stretch limo with four different rows of seats, just enough for all us Hart kids. And he'd let the midgets climb in there and they'd get in the back. And I can remember, I thought, it's great. And I can remember trying to headlock him and stuff like that. And if you ever, if you knew midget wrestlers, you know that you don't want to be headlocking them. They don't appreciate that too much. But anyway, wrestling was always part of my life. I remember we had sometimes the wrestling bear would come into town, and I remember they just would put him in a little cage underneath the front porch steps. And I remember, like, when we were kids, Hart kids always had black feet. You know, we just hang our feet down and drip ice cream off our toes. And I can remember that little bear licking my toes forever, you know. At least I got them clean. But I see superstar Billy Graham out here. My first experiences with wrestling, I'd be about 10, 12 years old, and I'd go down to the basement. My dad would be with all these huge wrestlers. And I remember you were kind of safe when you were about that age. You know, 12, you were okay, you know. You could sit down there, and as long as you didn't say anything, and it was pretty interesting to watch. You know, he'd put these guys in all these holds, and they'd be screaming for their lives down there. I think my mom sometimes, I don't know what she thought. I think she phoned the police and was worried that somebody's getting killed down there. But anyway, my dad was an amazing character, and I want to say first that I owe everything I am today to my dad. And the man I always longed to be was the one I first thought my father was. He was a one-of-a-kind guy in this business. And I can remember when I first got in, I'd always introduce myself around the dressing room as Bret Hart, Stu Hart's kid, and this was always my passage to safety. And everybody I know that really understood him and got to know him loved him, and he was everything that was good about the wrestling business. And I know he would be really proud of me today standing here. Got all kinds of funny stories and memories. I'll try not to go too long here. It would only be right for me to tell a few funny stories about my brother Owen. My brother Owen was, he was a hilarious guy. I can remember being on the road and I get a call from somebody telling me that the hotel was, or that somebody, delivery service, or somebody was giving me a free pizza. You know, I think I've already eaten, and they, you know, they'd sell me on the, it's free, and they're bringing it up, and it's on the house, and I'm like, okay, you know. So, and then next thing you know, I'd be arguing with the guy about he would want me to pick my toppings, you know, what kind of toppings I wanted. And I was like, okay, so I'd start going through the toppings, and then he'd start pushing more toppings on you. And finally you're going, then he'd tell you after that he's gonna charge you for the toppings. And you'd go through this charade all the time. And anyway, that was Owen, you know. He was, I remember we were checking into a hotel in Dayton, Ohio, and all the wrestlers were walking in, and Jim Duggan was there with his wife, and he'd gone already been to his room, and we're all standing around the front desk signing in, and Jim Duggan phoned down, and he asked the guy at the front desk, he goes, where's the gym? And the guy goes, he's talking on the phone, he puts his hand over, he goes, anyone know where the gym is? And Owen goes, you know, give it to me. So he hands the phone over to Owen, and Owen gets on the phone, and of course Jim Hacksaw just thinks it's somebody at the front desk. And anyway, Owen tells Hacksaw that, you know, why don't you look it up yourself, you lazy bastard. You wrestlers, so lazy, just look it up. And so Hacksaw got all kind of worked up with him, and you know, and then Owen's telling him, if you want to do something about it, come down here and I'll kick your ass. And Hacksaw couldn't believe it. So then Hacksaw, he You know, he's getting dressed and coming down to the lobby to straighten out this front desk guy. And I remember Owen just hands the phone back to him. And the guy says, don't do this to me. He goes, don't worry. Just tell him it's me, Jim Powers. So I just know Hacksaw came down and, you know, the guy goes, hey, it wasn't me. It wasn't me. It was Jim Powers. And I remember that night in the dress room, Hacksaw came up to Jim Powers, and that was funny anyway. My favorite story about my brother Owen relates back to my father, and I remember it, I think it was WrestleMania 4 in Atlantic City. I brought my dad down, and he was just so happy to be there. You've seen all the old, you know, all the guys that he, so many of the old timers that he remembered, and he was just in such a great mood. And he was rooming with me, and I remember I got up in the morning, and my dad was just kind of getting up, and the phone rang, and I answered it, and talking with, it's like, it's Reg Park, you know, on the phone, and it's like, and it was Owen, you know. I didn't know it was Owen, but he said it was Reg Park, and he wanted to say hi to my dad. So I hand the phone over to my dad. I go, it's Reg Park. And so my dad, Reg is was a really nice, easygoing kind of guy, and I think he was a bodybuilder. And anyway, so Owen, my dad gets on the phone, and next thing you know, I'm just watching my dad, and he's starting to pace around the room, and he's got the phone, and he's got his nightshirt. You know, he's still just waking up, and I remember he's getting all worked up, and I guess Owen was on the phone, you know, telling him that my dad didn't have the balls to, you know, ever mess with him, you know, that if you know, he kept pushing my dad's buttons. And you know, I remember as I was there with my oldest daughter Jade, who's here tonight, and I remember my dad going, Reg, if you'd wanted to try me, why didn't you try me, you know? And I remember he got so worked up. I mean, he was like red and paced around, and the veins were coming out in his forehead and all that. And then all of a sudden I just saw him. He just slammed the phone down, sat down. And he looked at me, he goes, that bastard Owen, he got me, you know? I remember Owen, he told me that he was pushing my dad's buttons so much that he couldn't take it anymore. He was laughing. Like, my dad was, he was saying all kinds of stuff to my dad. And, you know, it was one of those great stories with my brother Owen. If you knew him, I'm sure he pulled a joke on you somewhere. Anyway, I remember in the beginning of my career, I had a chance to, got called, and they said they needed me to take the Dynamite Kid's place, and he was wrestling in Madison Square Garden against the great Fujinami, Tatsumi Fujinami from Japan. And anyway, he couldn't get across the border, and I was called up at the last minute. And I remember I got to the building, and this was such a big thing for me. I was only about 20 years old, maybe 21, and I remember I was walking through the lobby getting ready for that big walk over to Madison Square Garden. I kept thinking to myself, someday I'm going to tell my kids that I wrestled in Madison Square Garden, you know. And anyway, they met me, and the Japanese guys that had sort of brought me in for this, and they stopped me in the lobby, and they said, we had to take you off the card. You didn't have a big enough name to wrestle in Madison Square Garden. And I remember that in the beginning of my career. And when I first got to the WWE in 1984, I was fortunate and lucky enough to be part of this new, you know, surge in wrestling, thanks to Hulk Hogan and Vince and the whole team of wrestlers that took wrestling to a whole new level. Back in those days, wrestling was pretty tough. It was a lot of, I worked 304 days my first year in wrestling, and I think I worked pretty much close to that for the next 6 years that I was in the WWE. double shots, and it was a tough life. But I want to say here and now that I would never have made it through those days and those years if it hadn't been for my tag partner, Jim the Anvil Neidhart. Jim the Anvil Neidhart was one of the, you know, he was just the greatest character. You know, I got a little pug over in Italy right now that I keep him, I think, just because he reminds me of Jim. You know, he got those sad puppy dog eyes, you know. Every time he wants you to have one more round, you know. But I've got so many funny memories and stories about Jim the Anvil Neidhart. I'll just tell one. And I remember Owen had just flown in. I think he was getting a new start in WWE back in somewhere around 1991, maybe. And I think we were just getting to do, we'd just done one night in Texas or something. I worked with Skinner. But anyway, all the wrestlers were kind of celebrating, and I took Owen to a strip bar in San Antonio. And Owen was, he wasn't really prone to those kind of places, but I managed to talk him into it because it was a big night for him. He was starting in WWE, and he'd flown in from Germany. And it was a crazy night, that night in Texas, I'll tell you that much. Because I remember we were all drinking in the bar, and everyone's kind of talking and stuff, and next thing I see Vince coming in. And Vince had had a few soda pops somewhere else, you know. He was primed up and ready that night, and I remember, I think Sergeant Slaughter might remember this, he was driving, thank God. But anyway, I remember just kind of, you know, hanging out in the bar with Owen, and I remember Hulk, who, you know, he could always stir up shit, you know. And he was stirring up the Legion of Doom. He was stirring up the Legion of Doom and he'd get them all worked up. And I remember Hawk and Animal, and they were talking about how they were going to do their finish on Vince. And I remember watching it and I'm thinking, no way. They're not going to do it. Nobody would do their finish on Vince, you know. And next thing I see Hawk's talking about, he's not kidding, and Joe's kind of going along with what Hawk's doing. And quite a few of the wrestlers are kind of starting to mark out over this and see if this is actually going to happen. Jim's pulling on the beard, and anyway, next thing I see Joe come up behind Vince, and like I say, Vince was in a pretty good state of mind anyway. So he came up from behind and he hoisted Vince up, rigged him right up, and I look and there's Hawk up on the little table, one of the poles, and I'm waiting, I'm watching, and I think, here it is. They're gonna take his, it's gonna take Vince's head off with this, you know, their finish was bad enough as it was, you know. Anyway, I mean, stiff enough anyway. And Hawk came off with a really nice little powder puff kind of clothesline, and I remember Hulk and Beefcake and everybody kind of caught him and set Vince down, and everybody was kind of, I think they even gave a little golf clap. And I can remember I had a couple of beers in my hand. I think I had a shot of Jack Daniels. And I could see Jim pulling on his beard. You know, he was just, he goes, Hart Foundation would have done it. And I said, I had a look at him. And I can remember thinking, I better get out of here. I couldn't set my drinks down fast enough. I mean, I knew it. I told Owen, I said, I got to get out of here right now. And next thing you know, Jim's got him up in the bear hug, and I'll never forget it. I remember Hulk looking at me, kind of like, so what's going to happen here? And I took Vince's head off. Jim the Anvil Neidhart, I remember so many funny stories about him, but I can't resist telling this one. I remember when we'd stay in the hotel, you'd hear them. We'd always forget to put the do not disturb on the doorknob, and we'd be lying there, you know, in bed, and I could hear the maid fumbling with the key and coming in the room, and I'd be like sound asleep, and I just remember just sort of hearing Jim pull the whole blanket off, you know, and just be lying there like a big starfish, and then you'd see the maid come in. And yet, I mean, we went through this quite a few times. It was standard Heart Foundation, and you hear them scream and get out of the room as fast as they could. Over a period of time, I think we could do it in stereo, you know. But I wouldn't be where I am if it wasn't for Jim the Anvil Neidhart. And there's a lot of wrestlers I want to take the time to thank. In my early days, I want to say that I will never forget Cowboy Bob Orton, Rowdy Piper, Don Morocco, Mr. Fuji, Iron Sheik, and so many others that every night they were my family, and I love those guys. And I had some, let's see. I wish I could have one more match. I want to take the time to think about and remember some of my great matches and great experiences I had. I'll never forget the matches I had with Mr. Perfect, Kurt Hennig. He was just the greatest guy to work with every night, and I never looked at working with him as work. It was a night off, and it was he was just the greatest guy to work with every night. He was just so much fun, and he was so safe and so careful, and I miss him. I remember wrestling him in Anchorage, Alaska, and I remember it was sold out, and I remember it was a big crowd, and Andre was working in those days with Warrior, and they were going about 25 seconds every night. And so they needed some extra time, someone to, you know, do the work out there, and I was working with Kurt, and I don't think I ever had a bad match with Kurt Hennig, but I remember that night we just had such a beautiful match, you know, I'll never forget it. I remember Kurt one time when we were in Salt Lake City. I think it was Arn Anderson's last night in those days in the WWE, was going back to WCW, and Ted DiBiase was in there with some guy he knew from college or something, and I guess he had a plastic ear, and he could just take it off. And he took off his ear, and no one was looking, he dropped it in Arn's beer. And I remember, because we were all celebrating Arn's career, and the beers were going down pretty good, and I remember Arn drinking the mug of beer, and he's singing that, I think it's a Hank Williams song about I don't know the song, but there's a tear in my beer or something like that. And anyway, I remember Arn tilting back and drinking it, and the ear went in his mouth, and I remember he spit out that ear and was hacking all over the place. But Kurt Hennig was a funny guy, and he made life in the dressing room really good. Another guy that I want to tell you about a story about was Earthquake. You know, I hope Earthquake, wherever you are out there, you're in my prayers. You know, I hope he's doing okay. I remember we were flying from Columbus up to Seattle or something like that, and connecting through Chicago. And we had about a 6 in the morning flight, and I remember we got delayed for hours, and everyone was sleeping on the floor near the gate, and it took hours and hours, and everyone was really tired and really cranky. And we finally got off, and we're in the air on our way to Seattle, and I remember poor Earthquake, he was in the very last seat in the airplane, in the very back, and he's a big guy, so he's against the wall sleeping with his head down. I remember I went to the back of the plane just to use the bathroom, and someone was in the bathroom, and Jimmy Hart was across from Earthquake. I was talking to Jimmy, and anyway, this little black kid came up, and he was about 4 years old, 5 years old, and he wanted my autograph, and I remember I signed it for him, and then he asked Jimmy to sign it. And then he looked over at Earthquake, and he goes, "Should I wake this guy up?" And Jimmy's going, yeah, go ahead, you know. And I'm saying, I say, yeah, he's a pussycat, you know, but Earthquake had had a, he'd had a long day, you know. He was, he about had enough. And I remember this kid kind of pulling on his coat and, hey, hey. And I remember Earthquake just looked up and his eyes were like red holes, you know. He just, anyway, he just yelled at this little kid and told him to get out, you know. And so and he put his head back down. I remember this little kid just looked around like this and he just leaned back and I couldn't believe it. He just slapped him as hard as he could right on the forehead. And I remember Earthquake, it's a good thing he had a seatbelt on anyway. He tried to rip, he tried to explode out of that seat. And I remember Jimmy Hart was trying to find a place to hide. And I remember, I kept praying, whoever's in that bathroom better come out, you know. But anyway, as you can tell, I had a life filled with all kinds of characters and great stories and memories. And you're welcome. You know, I remember, you know, I want to say that everything I did and everything I accomplished in the profession of wrestling, I did it for my kids. Every day, you know, you get up and it's not the easiest thing in the world to go out there all the time and entertain everyone else's kids. And, you know, it seemed like birthdays and Christmas, Halloween, Thanksgiving, Easter, you know, even, you know, you're just always entertaining somebody else's kids and you're packing your bags. And, you know, your kids pay the ultimate sacrifice. And I just want them to know that everything I did it for them. I remember a few months before the screw job, I was trying to put my youngest son Blade to bed, and it was in the summertime, and I ordered him up to go to bed, and he went up. I remember he really got mad, and he's got a pretty bad temper anyway. And he's slamming doors and making quite a fuss. And I remember finally put him in his room. And I went back downstairs and I was sitting in my kitchen. And it's like a half hour later, all of a sudden I see Blade come down. And he's got Sean's t-shirt on and he's got Sean's hat. And he's got the Sean glove and he's looking at me like this. And he's opened his hand and I remember looking at him. I said, so what are you supposed to be? And he looks at me, he goes, I'm in the click. Anyway, I still put him to bed. But I remember telling Sean that story. But, you know, when I think back to those days of the Hart Foundation with Brian Pillman, Jim the Anvil, the British Bulldog. Owen, those were the happiest days, I think, of my life. And I always look back on those days with, you know, a real deep fondness. And I was lucky that I wouldn't be where I am today if it wasn't for the great fans I've got all around the world. And if I could give any advice to all the young wrestlers out there, never forsake your fans. You know, never forget them, because if he's a fan of yours, you want to hold on to them for as long as you can, as they'll take you. You know, I want to say that that I was a real world champion. I traveled around the world, and I was really proud to be a world champion. That you know, I wrestled in India, I wrestled in Israel, I wrestled in South Africa, I wrestled in the Philippines, I wrestled in so many places. And Germany, I want to say special thank you to all the fans I had in Germany. I remember they'd knock down the barricades and trample people just to come up and, you know, give me a big hug before my match or after my match. It was a beautiful experience that I'll never forget, and They were probably the most loyal and devoted fans I ever had. Canada, you know, I was always a Canadian first. You know, I never ever forgot where I came from, and you know, people always say, why would you wear pink, you know? But I, you know, pink was a very special color for me. It was, you know, if you mix a little red and white together, you get pink. And, you know, I always thought, sometimes I thought, you know, maybe I should have had a better color through my career. You know, maybe black and gold or something would have been a little nicer. But, you know, there was something very neutral about pink as a color. And I always said it took a real man to wear pink. But at the same time, I think it's always good to know that you can never be prejudiced against a color. You know, pink can be whatever you want it to be. And I love the color pink. I want to get ready to close here, but I want to say that, you know, and to the wrestlers, you know, that and you need to pace yourselves for the long haul. And it's not about so much about hurting one another. It's respecting the art. And I wrestled for 23 years. And it's not easy to go out there every night and, you know, describe yourself as the best there is and the best there was and the best there ever will be. But I wrestled 23 years. I never injured one wrestler ever that I know of anyway. And I was a pretty physical wrestler. And, you know, it's the whole business is about trust and respect. And there's a deep meaning behind the word doing the honors. And, you know, I want to thank every wrestler that I ever worked with anywhere around the world. And in closing, I want to thank my wife in Italy. You know, when I had my stroke a couple of years ago, I remember I got emails and letters from fans all around the world saying they were praying for me, and they must have been praying good, because I was lucky and fortunate to have been blessed with a great recovery, and I'm standing here today, and if I hadn't had the recovery that I have, you know, I would never have met the sweet angel that has saved me over in Italy. I just want to say she's over in Italy now with my pug, and I just want to say hi to her. Cinzia, thank you for being my angel. And I want to thank everybody for all the great memories. Wembley Stadium, all my fans in England. That was my favorite match that I ever had, and I'm happy to tell you that. And I wouldn't change that minute, that moment for anything. And I guess I'm going to wrap up here, but I just want to say that you know, for the wrestlers and everybody and everyone around the world, if I could give one message to them, it would be that the best chance you have if you want to rise to the top is to give yourself up to loneliness, fear nothing, and work hard. One thing you'll discover is that life is based less than you think on what you've learned, and much more than you think on what you have inside you right from the beginning. And I'm happy to say that you don't have to worry about me anymore. I'm good. I'm happy to be alive. I'm glad to be here. And I thank every one of you for coming out here tonight. Thank you very much.
Give a big round of applause to all the WWE